So I will try to explain what's the current tourism tourism model is, why we looking for conservation tourism, and what kind of choices we have if we're going forward, and why do we need tourism, any kind of tourism in our conservation centers and things like that. Before I go there, I would like to thank Snow Leopard Trust, GSLED, Snow Leopard Network, and Rocky, Justin, Ranjini, and Gustav for inviting me to talk about conservation tourism for snow leopard habitats. And just to give a background, I've been involved with snow leopard research long ago. Then I moved on to tigers. But for the last 10 to 12 years, I've been a tourism professional. So I've seen the conservation side of it. I've looked at the tourism from that other side of the boundary. And then I've now chased the court and now in the tourism side and looked at the tourism inside out. So I've got a completely different perspective, which I will try to share with you. And now we're trying to use, try to develop models of tourism which can benefit conservation. And what's the, why we're looking for new different model of tourism? And one of the reason is that the current tourism is not designed or developed and guided for conservation purposes. It is actually looking at to economic benefits for the country, for the industry, for individuals. The main focus, the priority is the growth in numbers and visitation. So the more money, I'm saying, and how you can maximize the profitability and things like that. And that's why it's not very conservation or nature or environmentally friendly. A lot of tourism now started happening since 60s, 70s in our in and around our conservation areas, where people are coming for wildlife viewing. And that's where the conflicts comes in. Some people try to use terms like ecotourism, responsible tourism, nature tourism. These are very novel ideas. But what happens is that when it is used, these terms are used for marketing purposes to increase their growth in terms of visitation numbers, in terms of the valuation, in terms of the money coming in. Then you commodifying these novel ideas, actually not resulting in nature preservation, restorations, or conservation purposes. So what's the difference? What is the problem in our protected areas where you have tourism? What has happened is that we have a mainstream tourism which runs in historical monuments, cultural tourism, and we have taken that model and dumped it to our conservation centers. So if you're going to say Agra to see Taj Mahal, you select your hotel based on your choice, budget, and you buy a permit and go and see Taj Mahal and come out. You exactly do the same thing in tiger areas or snow leopard areas. You select your budget, select a whole place to stay, which is provided by an individual. You buy a permit if it's a protected areas, and you go see snow leopard or tiger and come out. There is a dealing between what you have contributed in terms of the money or whatever way, and conservation action. It does bring in individual benefits, livelihoods are increased, but whether it is reflected into a conservation, that's where the problem is. And when the same model, which is a mass tourism, which is looking at growth in visitation, is dumped into our conservation center, then you are start facing negative problems, and that's where some of the problems comes in. The other problem is that it's piggybacking on the success of somebody else's success stories. So the forest department has done wonderful work. We can go and see tigers. Some places community have lived in such a way that you can go and see snow leopard. And then somebody, a few individuals, then takes the benefit and market it properly, increase the growth, and contributed little in conservation and in community development. And those, so we need a conservation tourism, ecotourism, these terms come in, and we have to be very careful not to disregard the novel ideas. The second then question comes in, why do we want conservation centers? Do we actually want conservation centers to be a tourism destination? If we, when we have set aside an area for conservation purposes, why do we need tourism in there? That's something we have to look at very carefully, because once you ask these questions, then you will come up with much better idea, reasoning, much more rigorous discussions. If it happens, then you can come up with the reasons why we need tourism in these conservation centers. And do we actually want our conservation centers to be tourism destination? How does it going to help? Then the second question you will ask is, if we don't want our conservation centers to be tourism destination, why would we want tourism in conservation areas? So if they, we are not creating tourism destination, then why we want tourism in these areas? Then these are some of the very important key questions if we want to develop tourism-based conservation programs in any areas. These are some of the things which we need to be very rigorous about and critique it, look at very detailed, and also look at it, what we have been doing so far, and is it helping conservation or putting more pressure? In other areas, we can learn quite a lot of lessons from there. We have to see, and in the same area, what kind of tourism is happening. How is, why is not helping? How can we do things differently that it can help conservation? Those are some of the questions I think we need to ask. We have to look at the impact of tourism actions that's going to take place, how heavy its footprint would be, whether it will be sustainable, whether it will be environmentally friendly, small effort friendly, all these things we need to look into in details. Then we have to look at it, are individuals of the community are benefiting or a community is benefiting? Can we achieve our conservation goals if individuals are benefiting? Or we can do much better way of achieving our conservation goal if communities are benefiting. So these are some of the questions I feel are important for us to go through. And can we do conservation in these areas differently from what we have been doing, like protected areas? Can, do we need to create protected areas to achieve our conservation goal, or we can have different conservation models to achieve our conservation goals? So what are the choices we have, conservation choices we have? We have currently most of the conservation in India and in many parts of the snow leopard range is a very exclusive school of thought, where we have looked at that snow leopard and spray need a space to breed, to survive. And we have provided that space in form of protected areas, national parks, sanctuaries, or different names in different areas. So we have created that. And so, and then we have tried to keep everything outside this. So, it is a very exclusive conservation model. What is the problem with that is that it limits conservation within the boundary. It has no, conservation has no reach outside the boundary. So there are a lot of snow leopard areas which is beyond these boundaries get ignored. It's there in this model we have left outside the our boundaries. Participation or action in conservation on a volunteer basis. We have left its communities to participate, and if they want to participate, it's a very volunteer. Whereas within the area, there's an agency which is working very actively. Outside, it's left very voluntary. The other choice is very inclusive school of thought, where the belief is that snow leopard and its prey actually adds value to the to this space. If you have a landscape where there is no snow leopard, no prey, it's less valuable than if you have snow leopard and prey. So if there are no snow leopard, there are no prey or in low abundance, and it's ecologically vulnerable. We need to conserve that area, and that conservation by bringing these species adds value to the landscape. That's the difference between the exclusive and inclusive thought. And what it does is that it then extends the reach of conservation beyond our protected area boundaries. It also, the value from added value, which is added to the landscape, can then, when transferred into economic benefit to the communities, then there is an upliftment for the communities. And then if you can make design in such a way that that's economic incentives is then transferred into an action, then you can achieve your conservation goals. And and when you have economic benefits, you can create a very snow leopard friendly environment or perception among the communities. You can create a snow leopard friendly neighborhood around our protected areas. But it all depends on active participation of the community. And that's where the inclusive models become very, very important. And then all of a sudden your reach is is unlimited. There are all this lens, snow leopard range is now available for us for conservation and to happen. I have done, since I've been in the tourism for about 3 years ago, we did a study to look at the value of tourism in Tiger Reserve. I will share some of these, how much it generates, how much goes to the local community, what's its value for wildlife, what's the value for wildlife communities, mainly because tourism is a growing industry. And if you can take benefit of that, and it's an also an industry which can be snow leopard and tiger friendly. And nature friendly. If you can do it properly, you can use it as a conservation tool. It can bring a lot of incentives, a lot of money into the area, and can or add value to the landscape, and it can be then used effectively. And the idea is to take advantage of that growth that happens. And if you look at in India, in this, we are way below. And most of the actually snow leopard range countries are not there. And so there's a lot of scope for us to do and take advantage of this. And also it can then, as I said, we can extend it beyond our protected areas. But in the models so far we've been doing approaching as far as for conservation purposes or the tourism model, the community part of it is missing. There are three major component of any conservation scenario: is the government agencies, if they're protected area, and the land which is owned or landowners in India is the government. In some other areas could be private, and the tourism industry. So some places you can have these two, communities are not there. But if you're looking at an inclusive model, these three components are equally important, and that's we need to do this. And most of the existing model communities are not existing. Communities, it by the way, gets some kind of benefit, but it's not designed properly. So we need to develop conservation tourism or tourism in an area. We need to look at this, that all the three components are included. And the idea there is not so much to benefit wildlife, but the idea is to benefit communities. And the conservation. So if benefits from this industry is transferred to the communities, and then we can then use it as a leverage to do conservation in the area. In terms of the monetary, how much money actually generates, so we looked at 4 tiger reserves in central India. There was about 134 lodges that were operating at that time, I think 2017, and looked at the direct source of revenue, which is generated. That's what I can I'm not from the economic background, so I was not able to calculate the indirect economics that's also involved in this, but we're looking at only direct money. So from 130 lodges, we were generating about $23 million. And if you look at how much government is spending, if you look at Fort Niagara Reserves, total money spent is $4.7 million. And if you look at the assistance from the federal government was $5.7 million. The state contribution was about $2.5 million. The entry fee alone is $2.7 million. Actually, central assistance is $2.7 million, not $5.7 million. So the contribution from the tourism towards conservation management is almost as good as what government is spending on conservation. But if you look at purely tourism money, it's about 15 million US dollar was going to the local economy. It is about 45% of the total turnover of 23 million. If you include the entry fees, it was about 56 million. So there's a huge amount of money that was going into the community, but it was not translating into a actionable conservation action. And that's the problem with the current tourism model, because it's not designed and created for conservation purposes. But what it does is that it creates upliftment, and despite it's not designed, what we noticed that the perception of people in the community was very different. So we compared some of the tourism villages and non-tourism villages in the same protected area. Villages where tourism is happening and in areas where tourism is not happening, realize if you have a shop, you earn three times more in tourism village than in non-tourism village. And that actually had created a kind of perception, the income generation has created perception in some of the tourism villages. People were so keen to talk to us that it was difficult for us to get out. Then we were offered meals, tea, everything. And everybody wants to share their how good they feel about tiger, having tiger neighboring. But in the non-tourism village, maybe another neighboring village, you go, they were very anti-conservation mindset there. In some places, we were not even allowed to go inside the village. There was a hostility against us. So tourism has a very, very high value in changing perceptions, how people can be made tiger friendly. But the only problem there was that it was limited to only 11 villages. In four tiger reserves, only 11 villages are benefiting from tourism, and maybe about 250 villages which are around all our protected areas had not seen 1% of benefit. And that's something, some of the problems associated with. Now, if you change from the model which we're running tourism to into a conservation tourism, we will need quite a lot of policy changes in our system to facilitate, to create an environment where conservation tourism can happen. It needs to create an environment where incentives can be generated. To give you an idea, the benefit of having conservation tourism is that I've just tried to compare Ranthambore, Lewa, and Old Pajeta. Lewa and Old Pajeta are in Africa. But if you can look at it, the size more or less very similar sizes. the number of visitation, you can see quite a lot. In this case, I think it's the tourist number, not the visitation number. Visitation number, these are also tourist numbers. So here, not only 465,000, but I think you can easily say about 120,000, because the same tourist visiting several times, but still very high visitation number in Ranthambore. The the money coming in Ranthambore from the government source is about 1.8 million. From tourism through the entry fee is about 2.8 million. And from other sources, almost nothing. So you're looking at total money coming as 4.6 million to Ranthambore. In Lewa, with maybe 10 times less tourists, government is a private game reserve. So there's no money from coming from government. Tourism contributing only 1.56 million. From other sources is 0.5 million almost. So total is about six and a half million. And if you look at Dol Pajeta, a very similar situation. Government, no money. Tourism is only three. Other sources. So the once you do bring in conservation and tourism as a conservation tool, and you have a success story, conservation success story, what it does generate is that you can create a conservation-based economies. A lot of charity will come in, a lot of other support system will come in, will generate even twice as much money than tourism will generate. And that's something very, very, very important in this inclusive conservation model. And where you fail to do this in a very exclusive protected area based model. So we're entirely dependent on government support system and to tourism to some extent. But when you do inclusive model, you can generate substantial amount of conservation-based economy. And the potential is enormous. And what it does is that if you have conservation success story, local benefits, employment, attitudinal change, and wider conservation network. So you can create a much larger number of these conservation centers with the help of tourism. But the key is that for planning for the growth in conservation and also in terms of community development, we need to create a conservation framework within which tourism has to operate, because this tourism is designed for conservation purpose. So if you tourism action happens, there is other side, there is a conservation action happening. So those two has to be linked, and it has to be run within the conservation framework. So you have to develop, you have to promote, and you have to guide that tourism with conservation interest in mind. So there are two basic principles I find are very key for developing these things. So that it's that you have to run this within the conservation-based framework, and primary beneficiaries are the communities. So the benefit from the tourism goes to the communities, not to the individuals. And that's very key, because you cannot get communities to participate and conservation to happen based on individuals. Individual livelihood, welfare will happen, individual family will benefit, but you, with a few, say 10% or 20% of the community participating with you, is not going to lead to conservation. It actually start dividing the community. So it has to be very carefully done how you can use this benefit for the community. And it has to be in the primary benefit. And then example which I want to give here, and maybe we'll discuss a little later in the subsequent sections, is the work which we did in Rumba. When I finished my PhD, then we started working with communities. Then the compensation schemes came in, crop damage compensation came in. All of a sudden, the perceptions of the communities started changing. So far, the animals were part of their life, they were theirs. But since the moment government came in, created national park, they started giving compensation, the animals belong to the government. And then resentment starts happening. So we thought we need to do something. So we started with Earthwatch groups. We started taking horses, which is about 25 horses. We bring in 5 or 6 groups. It's a subsequent amount of money from the horses and other things started coming. Initially, we took individual families' horses. And then the community came, why are we not taking our horses? So then we realized very early on that this is not the right way of going up approaching. And they didn't have a system where the communities can decide. But fortunately, there was a Gompa. And they said, all the money generated is given to the Gompa, and then Gompa will decide how who will provide the horse, who will provide what kind of support. So the it's kind of went there, and then community started getting benefit. A substantial amount of money started going. They started seeing the benefit, and that kind of created, changed the perception, which actually started going in a negative direction from the compensation scheme started by the government to create more smaller friendly communities in the areas. They started looking at smaller in a different light. We had to work quite a lot to translate those benefits into conservation actions, and there not much at conservation action actually required. What needed was that only the perception, the we want created a snow leopard friendly communities in the Rumbuk area, and then it took off from there. And by the time I left, snow leopard conservancy started taking care of the conservation work in that area, spread into many other different landscapes. But this is just the point I make, is that the community benefits will bring the community together. Individual benefits will split the community, and then it will make conservation actions much more difficult. So this is just a conservation concept, which more idea I have put together. What is inclusive conservation model? Are we working on tiger in one area where I will share how the infrastructure, structure we have created. Basically, we're looking at the output of the inclusive conservation is that we're going to restore wildlife populations. We want to restore the habitats if there is any habitat that needs to be restored. This conservation model will manage the conflict that exists. And I think if the community themselves are doing the conservation, then I think there is no scope of conflict. And it can control poaching. The local management is very, very key. The local management and the goal would be to create snow leopard friendly neighborhood. They will be looking into the habitat restoration. They will be co-managing if it's if the land is owned by some different communities. The two communities can co-manage. They will facilitate research, and I think research is very, very key. And also the long-term research, 2 months, 2 years research projects not going to contribute too much in conservation. But the long-term project, if you look at snow leopard conservation success stories in Spiti or in Rumbuk, it's the long-term presence of a researcher made a big, big difference. So the long-term project does create those kind of perception change in the communities. It can bring in social welfare if you have an inclusive conservation model by creating multiple livelihood options. This ownership is very key. They own the conservation success. The economic benefits of that, it can bring in economic well-being and generate employment. So all these things, tourism, carbon trading, so not so much for snow leopard areas, but red plus or something in some of the snow leopard areas in Kyrgyzstan all could be very important value addition to conservation purposes. We're looking at, as I said, that these philanthropic and enterprise development can bring in more money than the tourism can bring in. So I think we have to take advantage of those resources in achieving our conservation target. So in an area, in a village, Jinnah, where we're looking at the land belongs to the forest department, we're looking at they come together, create an entity through an agreement. So that the local community, the landowners, and conservation partners, it could be NGOs, it could be tourism, and all three together forms an entity, and they then manage the area. then the second part of it is that then the actions taken by that structure which has been created through the agreement, the actions for say it's this very tiger centric, so they will do the protection, they will work on habitat restoration by removing livestock grazing in certain areas, manning visitation of tourists, to regulating the tourism in this area, grazing regulations, crop protections, education, nature education, animal husbandry, and that's something which is very, very crucial. and then outcome we are looking at is better pasture land, reduce conflict, restore wildlife populations, habitats, and then the ownership of the work they have done. And more importantly, so social welfare, income generations, employment in this community. So the policy support, then what kind of policy support do we will require? So that recognized tourism without infrastructure is no leopard friendly activity. So we need to create, at least in India, the way the law is, the tourism is not considered any tiger friendly or nature friendly or forest friendly activity. So any tourism activity in these areas is prohibited. So the policies may be required, may not be very relevant in some of the snow leopard range countries, but where it is relevant, we need. But the key is that the tourism without creating much infrastructure in the snow leopard habitat. guide multiple inclusive approaches. We need different conservation models. Currently, we are stuck with one protected area-based exclusive conservation model. I think the idea is to develop different conservation model. One could be based on tourism that we were discussing, but there could be different approaches. I think like hunting concessions, tourism concessions can be given exclusive. And once you give exclusive rights, a lot of money investment, private investment can come in. That's very, very key. Then we have to empower villages by creating some legal framework so they can receive financial benefit, go into agreements, so that they can be owner of that area. Plus is also in India is very, very significant because the way the government of India has lifted it, that about 250,000 rupees, which would be about say £2,500 per square kilometer. So if you're covering large areas, it could be a significant amount of money if that value is transferred and rights are transferred to the communities. Then you have an additional value added where they can then see how they can increase their livelihood by modifying their livestock husbandry without going into the some areas and getting the compensation from red funds. So those are some of the things will be available if we empower the community to accept by diverting the right to the communities. And overall, just create a suitable environment for tourism to create conservation success stories. We should not all be dependent on government to do the conservation. If the communities can participate and create their own success stories and make money, add value to the snow leopard habitat, and then I think we need to create that kind of environment by creating a proper legal framework. And I think, Kaustubh, I will just leave it here. And then we can start discussions. These are some of the posters which we have created for Ladakh maybe a decade ago or something like that. If I wanted to share some of these.